Welcome to episode 7 of the Future of Healthcare podcast.
Great. Welcome back, everybody. I'm here with Matthew Bailey. Matt, you want to introduce yourself?
Yeah, so my name is Matthew Bailey. I am a starting fifth year graduate student at Washington University in St. Louis. Thanks for having me.
Yeah, no, of course. We're excited. Just so you guys know, so I might call him Bailey every once in a while in the lab. That's what we refer to him. But Matthew and I, he's been kind of my mentor for a little over a year now. When I started doing some research over at Washington University, Matt was really showing me the ways and really kind of got me started and really interested in like big data and bioinformatics and those things. And today we're going to kind of jump into a lot of what he's been working on. But I guess just to start, why don't you kind of talk about like your academic career and kind of where you started and before you got to where you are today?
Yeah. So I was an undergraduate at Brigham Young University.
BYU.
BYU, yeah. Go Cougars. But really interesting. So I got, just as a freshman, I was thinking medical school. Everybody that I was talking to, they gave me the advice to join a lab. And I shopped around at a couple of different labs looking around, and I identified someone doing Alzheimer's genetics at Brigham Young University, Keone Kawe. And didn't quite know where to start on how do you join a lab. So I had tracked him down. I went to his lab a couple times. I met a few of the students that were doing work in his lab. And he was on vacation in Hawaii or something, doing something great with his life. And the students mentioned that they were presenting at a poster session and science conference in Park City. And I hadn't met Keone at this time, and I wanted to meet him. I wanted to join his lab. And I remember going home and saying, "Hey, Dad, I really want to go to this conference, but I have no financial means to get there or anything." So he gave me a couple bucks for gas. I drove up there, paid my way for the conference just to meet my professor.
Wow.
And so he had given a talk earlier that day or something, and I met him at lunch, and one of the graduate students that I'd met, or not graduate students, but one of his undergraduate students that was doing research in his lab, introduced us, and he's like, "Oh, great, good to meet you. Why are you here at this conference? Do you have a poster?" And I'm like, "I'm actually here to meet you. I want to join your lab." And so that was kind of the introduction to my undergrad PI. Kind of sought him out, and I don't know if it was my eagerness or naivety that got me into his lab, but ended up just shadowing a couple of the students in his lab, getting a feel for what they do. I know I'd always been interested in genetics. I was always fascinated in my high school biology classes that this tiny molecule could code for life.
Yeah.
And thought this would be a good opportunity to kind of get my feet wet. I'd taken a course from him. One of his TAs was a bioinformatics undergraduate major.
Yeah.
And he convinced me that it was probably a good route and ended up joining his lab. And the rest is kind of history.
So when a lot of people who are getting involved in kind of healthcare during their college career are looking to go into research, and
sure,
you were very ambitious by going to a conference all the way to just meet the person you were looking to research with. But lots of people find it daunting to go out of the way and like reach out to people. But do you have any advice? I know now, being a graduate student, doing like a lot of research now, you probably have a lot of interactions with people who've gone through different experiences. But like,
mm-hmm,
what type of advice do you have for people who might be looking to do that?
Often people are flattered when you can go out of your way and say, "Hey, I've done some research on you. I think you're doing cool stuff." It doesn't matter who you are or what you're doing. If you're interested in somebody's work, feel free to approach them and say, "Hey, I notice you."
Mm-hmm.
First off, I think it's one, flattering, and two, don't be afraid to work for Cokes, right? Just don't be afraid to work for Coca-Cola and a drink, because just getting that foot in the door is a really big deal.
Yeah. And then so when you're Alzheimer's mm-hmm. genetics research.
Yeah.
What exactly were you doing with like it at that time?
Yeah, so really at that time, I was just getting used to working in a Unix system and a couple different software packages that the lab was using. So how much technology do you want to get into? Like
We can go surface level.
So essentially there was a technology in the early 2000s looking at what you might call kind of a smattering of genetic variants across the entire genome. Often these are common variations that occur across the general population, and the hypothesis at the time was that common variants lead to common diseases such as cancer, Alzheimer's disease, diabetes, heart disease, things of that nature. And the technology at the time were SNP chip arrays that gave you this smattering of genetic information, and then it was a simple association study trying to gather a group of control population and a group of cases and try to identify which variants were different between the two groups. It's a very simple study design that we eventually applied to more quantitative phenotypes.
And it's like, I find it interesting through my short time like at WashU's lab and seeing how like as it, the research you were describing and kind of the research that is now going on in genetics. But from there, your undergrad like position now in graduate school, why did you end up choosing to go into cancer genetics?
So there are a lot of different reasons to get into cancer genetics. Mm-hmm. One, it's it affects a lot of people, and everybody has a personal connection somewhere in your life to cancer. The other one is that cancer data sets have the best funding and the best data sets at this point, and I wanted to get my fingers in the latest and greatest.
Yeah, so
data.
Like what, I guess this is gonna be a pretty broad question, but
sure.
I feel like a lot of people who aren't intimately involved in genetics research have kind of a miss, like a, like as I was kind of referencing earlier, lots of people used to think all we needed to figure out was mutations, and mutations cause this. And it's like, perfect. We discovered, like, we coded the whole genome, and now we know the mutations. We're done. We figured it out. But I guess the more and more we've been looking into it, the more and more that's not totally the case. So, like, where is kind of this genetics field going right now?
So it's hard to tell, and there's a lot of hype that you're talking about.
Mm-hmm.
So 2000 comes out, the human genome is sequenced.
Mm-hmm.
We have the code of the world. Right? But in all systems, it's that hype that motivates, and that's the excitement around a story that pushes us to understand a little bit more.
Back into it here.
So cancer genomics, and where do you think the future is going? So just like anything in life, right? When you first dive into something, you're really excited about it, and then you learn about the complications of and the interactions and the network, and no matter what it is in life, it's the same in genetics. You're looking at the interactions between multiple genes, and then it's right now it's an interesting place because it's moving so quickly that the only fruit, or everybody's in a race to grab the lowest hanging fruit.
Mm-hmm.
So as different technology comes out, you'll have waves that come through and pluck the low hanging fruit, and the technology keeps moving. And I think it might be a while still, and I don't know if the technology will ever slow down, but you'll have an opportunity to go back and look at some of the early hypotheses that we've had, like I was talking about earlier,
mm-hmm.
that turn out to be much different than we thought at the time.
Yeah. If you kind of lead reference to it, how I guess something that I always found interesting with my time in the lab when I was kind of a fly on the wall gathering as much information as I could, and but the competitiveness of the environment and the speed of which it is, and it's all about you're going after some finding and you want to be the first one there.
Sure.
And I guess it's kind of the environment of academic research, and I was wondering if you could kind of talk to us a little bit about that.
Yeah, so I've been thinking a lot about that too. So coming from a bioinformatics background, I have a little bit of stats, a little bit of biology, and a little bit of computer science. And I've sat in meetings where Google executives are, one might say, presiding over the meeting and telling about their latest and greatest applications to study genomic research. And as a budding bioinformatician, I'm really threatened by the idea that Google and their minions of incredibly smart computer scientists are tackling problems that I want to tackle as well. But what I've come to realize is it's not necessarily, you have to develop the skills to be able to ask the questions that you want, but Google or anybody can't ask every question. And so it's not necessarily the fastest, but asking the right questions and being able to have the skills or develop the skills needed to answer that question. And that was one of the big motivators for picking bioinformatics, with everything moving to bigger and bigger data sets, Excel and different tools that you've grown up with in your education don't cut it anymore. And I wanted to be able to ask a question and develop and have the skill set to answer that question.
And I guess for people who don't totally know, but bioinformatics,
yeah,
like what is that? And I mean, that's really passionate about. So like dive into that a little bit so people kind of get, because I mean you said it, but that's where it's all going, this big data. Like we keep using big data, like that's where it's going. And Excel, it just can't handle it. And people would be like, what do you mean? I do everything in Excel, but like no genetic information. Like, isn't an entire genome almost like a terabyte of data or something like that? It's like an insane amount of information that normal computers can't handle.
Well,
but, so
normal computers can handle it, but applications that are easy to use can't handle it.
Yeah, so bioinformatics, let's
Yeah,
dive
so in. What is bioinformatics?
Yeah.
That's a broad question. So, and it spans a lot of different fields and it means different things to different people. But from my perspective, bioinformatics is using kind of lower level coding to handle, manipulate, and ask biological questions. So there's an element of computer science, there's an element of statistics, and there's an element of biology. So you have to understand the biology to make sure that you're asking meaningful questions. You have to know statistics to make sure you're getting meaningful answers. And you have to have the computer science because the data is too big to think about it otherwise.
Mm-hmm.
So for me, there's the angle of bioinformatics where you're building tools and applications. So let me try to build an app for genomics.
Mm-hmm.
Essentially, it's not something you'd see necessarily on an iPhone.
Mm-hmm.
But you're going to build some type of package that has a specific purpose. Or from an analyst's perspective, you're bringing in a little bit more of the statistics and data visualization, which is the part that I really enjoy. And then those are kind of the two camps that I can see right now in bioinformatics.
And like, so which camp are you more into?
Oh yeah, definitely the data visualization analytics.
Yeah.
I know how the tools work, and I really like using other people's tools when they're made clean and easy to use, obviously.
Clean and easy is the key.
Clean and easy, it's always the first pass, and those are will be the most successful often.
I mean, that was something that right away when I got into like your lab, when was one of the first things I learned about was Hotspot 3D.
Sure.
And it was
one
of the most, I remember the very first meeting we sat down, you guys explained it to me. I was like, this is incredible. Then, like, I guess, do we want to explain that?
So Hotspot 3D is an application that was developed in the lab that I'm currently in under the direction of leading Adam Scott and Johini Sengupta and Beifeng Niu, if I pronounced his last name correctly. all got together and built a computational package that maps mutations onto 3D structures. Wow, that's really broad and probably not applicable to the audience. So let me break that down. So the central dogma of genetics, you have the code. The code is then read and turned into something functional that the body can use. And those functional parts are proteins. And throughout kind of early technology, in trying to identify the structure of the DNA, they have X-ray crystallography, which essentially shapes the protein and gives you what the protein looks like. So what our lab did was trying to, what we did is map mutations onto those structures and then try to identify if things that might be really far apart on a sequence level, so in a linear A, B, C, D, E, or position 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, if after the protein is folded together, if a mutation at position 1 and mutation at position 10, which may be relatively distant from one another, are actually close to one another in three-dimensional space. Mm-hmm. So with that being said, you might be able to talk about, hey, it's actually this side of the protein that we're seeing all these mutations on, not just the gene itself.
Yeah, and although you explain that so easily, but the whole concept behind it is, it's insane how in reality it's actually done. And I guess the reason why that's so important is because that goes beyond kind of what we referenced to earlier, where genetics start as we understand the linear code and we can find all these things out. But then we realize, oh, we have to go, what's the next step from the linear to the three-dimensional?
Yeah, but I think even a step before that is somebody noticed two different types of peas, right?
Yeah. Go all the way back.
You can kind of go all the way back to the beginning, right?
Yeah.
And you're trying to look around at the world that you see and notice differences and trying to find out where those differences occur.
Mm-hmm.
But yeah, so going from that linear to a three-dimensional, and then hopefully from that three-dimensional to a drug target, and from that drug target to a mouse model or a cell culture,
mm-hmm.
and then that to an early clinical trial, and then the clinical trial to something that actually has an impact on
mm-hmm.
our health today.
Yeah, and that kind of leads to the next question I kind of want to ask, where, so it's such a long process when it comes to research, and a lot of the work that you're involved in is, I guess, what's kind of considered preclinical research. It's a lot of the gathering all that information so that the next step is to apply that to research where you do investigate drugs and all these other things that are applicable to healthcare. But that requires a lot of work. And I knew before I got involved, I always thought, like, this university is doing research and they only talk to their university. And then the first thing I realized was, no, how unified, like, the research community is and how much they work together on things. And I was wondering if you can kind of touch on that to kind of explain, like, how much of a global mission a lot of these projects are to figure
sure.
these things out.
Sure. So I can give you from my perspective. So there have been a couple initiatives that have been started, and they're, when I say a couple, many across the country in different diseases, from ADNI, the Alzheimer's Disease Neuroimaging Initiative, to TCGA, which is the Cancer Genome Atlas, and ICGC, the International Cancer Genetics Consortium. All of these efforts have been pulled together, sequencing people from across the globe and aggregating them into data sets that multiple investigators can use. So to give you an example of a conference call that I frequent and have been trying to organize and help out is one that involves researchers, so here in St. Louis, as well as investigators at MD Anderson in Texas, Johns Hopkins University, investigators in Spain and Brussels, as well as Singapore, where we all try to get together and come up with cohesive stories and understanding of what these data are telling us.
Mm-hmm. And then, all these large efforts, do you feel like they're getting, all these large efforts connecting it to healthcare,
mm-hmm.
do you feel like they're getting the type of support or attention they need?
That's kind of a tough question. Being on the analytics side, I feel like we are always in short supply. Right? There are a number of investigators that have been organizing the groups to pull together the resources. And then on the analysis side, right now the bottleneck is at the end and the analytics.
Mm-hmm.
So we have as much support from governmental institutions, but we can only find things as fast as we can analyze it.
Yeah, and I guess it just gets more and more difficult.
Oh, yeah.
The more we figure out this, the more questions. And I've sat on a few meetings where somebody presents their findings that they've been working on, and we leave with like 20 more questions and leave standing there like, oh, we need to do this, or, and my mind is just like, wow, that's like 30 more things. That's like weeks and weeks of work. I'm like, oh, well, there we go. And it just keeps adding and adding on. And that's what keeps it exciting. And that's why it's important for young people who are getting involved in healthcare to start moving towards these things and reading these things. And I know one thing I always loved about what you would do is you would always, like, you're always reading more research and you're always continuing to investigate different things. How important do you think that is for people who are looking to get involved in healthcare, or whether it's just or just a research field in the healthcare sector, to continuously educate themselves and investigate new discoveries?
So that's an interesting question, because the things that get the hype, right? There are a number of different papers recently that come out with the latest greatest. So cancer immunology, huge topic right now in the field. CRISPR technology.
Mm-hmm.
A lot of these things make headlines for a reason. And often we can get by. There's so much information as well, right? Publications are coming out that you can't stay on top of everything. Because if you do that, you won't get anything done. If you're just always reading and trying to inform yourself about, if you trying to understand the whole process before you get started, would be terrible advice from me, right? So if you're
you literally told that to me one time, like, you need to stop looking and just start doing things.
Right.
Like, yeah, it's true.
Right. And then when you become comfortable, and when you're working with data that's so new and so fresh, everybody is essentially trying to ask the same questions you are. And if you wait or are reading only publications that, say, came out today, that research has actually been happening for the past year or the past 6 months. And so what you're reading are things that are 1 year in the past.
Mm-hmm.
So as soon as you get to the point where you feel comfortable with the literature that's coming out, you need to keep an eye on it, but make sure that you're always trying to ask, what's the next step, what's the next question? Because otherwise, you're going to be stuck in a closet just reading.
But do you see any problems come out of that, where all this research that's new is really
old?
Even though a year isn't old, but in research science, with all this new technology and the speed of it, it is. So do you see a problem when we might start investigating things, but you're really not gathering all the information you may need, or the answer may pop up once you're able
definitely,
to.
Definitely, and especially when you're building in multiple layers. Yes, so I do agree with you that way, because you'll have a computer scientist that doesn't know biology, and things that they might be finding are fairly rudimentary in the biological setting.
Mm-hmm.
So you definitely have to stay on top of that aspect, but it's also kind of a call to having a mentor, right? This is something that you can't do by yourself. And oftentimes, and I've been thinking about this a lot lately too, is that the best projects rarely come from a single individual. A lot of people our age say, oh, what can I do, me personally, to build this whole empire, right? But it takes a whole kingdom to have an empire, right? It's not just you. And so finding those individuals in your life that you look up to, that seem to be at the cutting edge, you have to rely a little bit on their expertise until you reach that level where you feel comfortable and know the history, know the background.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Did that answer your question?
No,
I feel
sure.
like I'm kind of talking around it.
No, for sure. And I guess the follow-up question to all this is what we're kind of talking about, where the speed of research is increasing. The technology development is just incredible right now, and all this. There's so much advancement, and we already discussed how everybody's kind of grouping together to answer these same questions. But as you near the end of your graduate career, where do you kind of see, I guess we started your future, but also just kind of the future of like healthcare research? Like, what type of insight do you have into that?
So very limited in my scope. I wish I had a larger scope. You can try to envision a time, right, where you have a completely computational model of a mouse or a cell line, that if you introduce one mutation into a cell, you know exactly what the outcome is before going to the wet lab. But I think we're still quite a ways from having a completely computational model of what each and every letter in the genome means, mm-hmm. and what is it, what's its implication for everything else.
Well, I feel like there's this kind of detachment that a lot of the general public may have with genetics, is mm-hmm. they believe we're almost there, but it's nowhere near.
No.
The unknown when it comes to genetics is still, it's still a mountain.
Sure. It's still a mountain, and it really gives me, like, a lot of the stories, though, that I've heard give me hope, because we're starting to find answers to things that we would have never known otherwise.
Mm-hmm.
We would have never known the root cause of these rare diseases that affect our loved ones without this information. And before you can fix a problem, you have to know where it starts. And so I think that's really the promise right now in genetics. And the thing that I'm really excited about is that discovery aspect. What is the root cause of this problem? What is happening at the cellular level
mm-hmm.
that is affecting these kids that we love, or the elderly who would like to stick around a little bit more?
Yeah. Well, I guess for you individually, what are some things that you're looking into? I know you can't, as a researcher, you can't always talk
sure.
about what is on the top of your mind, but generally, what are you kind of looking into now?
So again, going back, computation can only take you so far, and I would like to know what it takes. So say you find something behind your computer. You have a gene in it. You've tested everything you could against it. You've thrown this angle. You've thrown this question. You've looked at it against this, and it seems very promising. Like, what's the next step? Let's take it into something that's physical. Let's put it into a Petri dish and see if I can test the effects of the effects of this mutation. And then presumably it's something that you've identified in a disease cohort, right?
Mm-hmm.
So then it's something correlated with the disease. Let's take it to the next level. Does it turn this mouse crazy, potentially, right? Or
mm-hmm.
does it make this mouse not have feet? Who knows what the
yeah.
what the genetic mutation does, but can you introduce that and systematically identify what that mutation does to then treat it? The other thing that I'm really interested in, looking at some level, is just making sure that I don't get so caught up in the flow. Right, is making sure that, so...
Yeah, I was going to say, what do you mean
yeah,
by
yeah,
the flow?
Yeah. So oftentimes you'll find investigators or different people who like to ask a specific question about that, and you build your whole world around this one question that you often put on blinders on yourself. So trying to step out, what's the opposite of the question that I'm asking right now, and making sure that I understand both sides of the coin.
Can you kind of give us like an example of something?
Can I give you an
example
of something?
Is there one that's coming to mind right now?
Not off the top of my head. Like, so I have the one that I want to pursue, right?
Oh, okay. That's I know you can't. That was another thing, like the secretiveness of like research in like academia is a whole
funny.
New thing to me. I feel
that's
like
funny.
A lot of people don't understand everything that's behind
sure
it.
Sure. And to be honest, I've shared this with enough people that I'm not too concerned about somebody taking the idea, and hopefully, right, if they take the idea, something good comes of it.
Mm-hmm.
So I should be of the opinion to, if I have an idea, let's get it out and let's find an answer, even if I can't find it fastest. But the idea would be, are there, at least in the case of, go ahead.
I was going to say, I think this is the time when you're going to state it here, and then I'm going to be holding you accountable
in
the future.
Right, that I have to be able to answer this question myself.
So.
But one thing that I'm excited is to try to leverage, I guess, some type of gene-gene interaction, right? So something goes awry, is there a way to identify those parts in your question that are dependent on others? Can you identify the dependencies in a disease? So in cancer, you have a whole bunch of genetics that have gone haywire. Typically, I guess, depending on the cancer type. But you'll have cancer types that have completely altered genomes. But in order for them to continue to grow, they have to maintain some type of biological process. Is it possible to identify what those are and exploit those questions to maintain biological processes? Those are questions that I'm really interested in.
Yeah, and it's, and like you, some of you said, I feel like a lot of people always assume that cancer is, it's all caused by a single thing, or like, you know, it's, oh, it's, you know, there's mutations and it causes cancer, but it's, there's so many factors that go into it, and that's why it's so hard in the, like, the field you're in right now, where for each different cancer type, there's so many different causes, and that's, like, it grinds my gears when I see people toting online some crazy thing of like you, the pharmaceutical companies have a cure, but they're not, they're hiding it from us for money. And I started talking to somebody on Facebook who posted something like that, and they're like, you don't know, like, oh my gosh, like you don't know, you don't know anything. But it's difficult, but it's exciting. It's an exciting time. Man, it gets me pumped.
me too. That's why I'm still here, and I think I'm in it for the long run.
I guess a couple questions. Is there anything in relation to things you're working on, or kind of your how research and like academic research plays into healthcare that we haven't talked about, but maybe you wanted to reference before I ask you like a last few questions?
So there's so many different avenues that you can take here. Because I think it'll become more common practice. So you go into the overall goal, right, is to be able to tailor something specifically to you. And a lot of the questions is personalized medicine modularized or actually individual? And you kind of have to clump people at this part, at this point in the research, where you're going to say, hey, you have a similar mutation as this person. Let's try to treat you with this drug. And a lot of that is happening more and more. But what you're finding in some of these clinical trials is you'll have a subpopulation that responded really, really well to this interesting drug, but the rest of the population in your your test didn't do well at all.
Mm-hmm.
Can you identify the parts that made these individuals respond so well to the drug? And then be able to apply that to other people. So that's one of the goals in the current genetics landscape and in clinical trials, is to isolate the population that does well,
mm-hmm.
because tons and tons of money and resources have gone into the development of that particular drug,
mm-hmm.
with lots of hopes and aspirations as to what that drug will do, and testing it through, and to see a small number of the population perform like great results, and then the clinical trial fail.
Mm-hmm.
Is that a success or is that a failure?
Yeah, because I mean, it opens up all those questions of if a certain cancer drug could literally rid 10% of the population that have that cancer. Like, could they just totally rid them of that disease? When if it's only 10%, is the financially responsible to go into that, but at the same time you're you could be saving 10%, and it raises all these questions of how can we, is it good, is it bad? Like, yes, this is it could be a life-saving drug, totally 10%, but yeah.
Am I that 10%? And that's the question that you're going to want to ask yourself, like, am I that 10%? Mm-hmm. And I think as things progress, we'll be able to identify more clearly who that 10% mm-hmm. or 5% or 1% or even less than 1% mm-hmm. of people have. Mm-hmm.
And because currently, there have been multiple drugs found for, like, distinct mutations. And I believe in breast cancer, right? Or what type of cancers have... Like, there's some really big cancers that, like, if you have this mutation, like, here's the drug. And, like, there's a lot that are doing marvels already. But there's a lot that are still very hidden that we haven't figured out, right?
Yeah. Mm-hmm. There are tons. So, kind of early stories of leukemia. Now you're putting me on the spot, making sure that I know my stuff. and apologize. I apologize up front if I get this wrong. but a lot of these kinase inhibitors, so you'll identify... a kinase inhibitor, essentially you're trying to identify a small molecule that inactivates a gene that has been upregulated in a particular gene. So there's and I'm going to have to go, ooh, you might have to cut this segment out.
We can cut it out.
No, yeah. So I can tell you the genes, but I can't right off the top. So KIT or BRAF. So BRAF is a gene that is often mutated in skin cancer. And there's one particular mutation in BRAF. It's a V600E mutation. Mm-hmm. And this V600E mutation activates BRAF in the RAS pathway. Mm-hmm. And because it's overactivated, it leads or causes skin cancer.
Mm-hmm. I feel like it's so cool that we're able to break it down as we get more and more, and so we can literally track the pathways and mm-hmm. be like, this is the cause. And it's funny that you bring up the BRAF V600E, because that's when I was looking to the melanoma types, that was all I saw. And then we were able to connect that to UV exposure. And we're also looking into, what's the population that has skin cancer that isn't a result of the UV exposure?
So the prevalence of this mutation in skin cancer is roughly 50 to 60% of patients mm-hmm. that come into clinic with skin cancer, some type of melanoma, have this V600E mutation. And there's a number of different mutations just like this in different genes and different cancer types. So KIT, KIT at the 12 amino acid position. I can't remember the exact amino acids. Mm-hmm. There's a mutation in PI3K, so breast cancer, for example, that's a good example. Mm-hmm. You have the PI3K kinase pathway, mm-hmm. and often in breast cancer, I think it's position 1047, many, many breast cancer samples have this particular mutation in the PI3K gene,
mm-hmm.
PIK3CA gene, and being able to identify those and then have a particular drug target, I'm not as familiar with, but mm-hmm. I know that's continued research mm-hmm. in my lab.
Yeah, no, I just, it's so cool how there are some that we could identify fairly easily, especially mm-hmm. ones as prevalent as breast cancer, mm-hmm. which is great. But I guess kind of moving forward,
sure.
Is there anything that, if you kind of had the power to change one thing of kind of like the future healthcare, kind of the future of research or genetics research, what would kind of be one thing that you could, if you just had the power to change it, what would be that one thing?
So,
you can think about it for a second.
Yeah. So you have the power to change, or at this point, kind of on the scientific, I wish I just knew a couple more answers, right? If I just had this answer, I think it
mm-hmm.
would change everything.
But isn't that kind of what everybody kind of says?
Sure,
like,
sure.
I wish I had those couple more answers. But that's kind of the beauty of research. Is everybody wishes they had that amount, but it's kind of weird to get into it. The more you think about it, it breaks it down almost to human nature. Of we have this desire to understand, and we always wish we had more and more, and that's kind of the driving force behind this whole research pursuit that so many of us get involved with.
Right, and I think actually one aspect, there's a couple different things, right? Because I want to go to the doctor and the doctor say, hey, you need to exercise and eat well, right? And I think so many times we don't like the simple answers that people give us. And maybe from the selfish perspective, I wish that people did eat better and exercise. Because I think it put a lot of us out of a job if people listen to their healthcare professional at that end. But I think something that's a little bit more personalized than the root answer. Hey, if you eat well, exercise, and actually you have this predisposition to something that you're going to want to look out for. In such a way that people aren't afraid to live. So if you have a predisposition for, say, Huntington's disease or Alzheimer's disease, that it doesn't affect your life, but that it will engage you in the field, engage you in fundraising, being an advocate for a particular disease, so that the people take a personal investment into creating change that might affect more people.
Mm-hmm.
I think that would be really exciting if people could be positive about hearing bad news in such a way that, hey, we're actually really close, and if that there are things that you can do close to home, near your universities, or even in practice, that say, hey, doctor, I've been reading up in here, and it's hard right now because, say, for example, you get a genetic test on your own accord, gives you a result back, and you're really nervous about it, and you go straight to your doctor and say, like, I'm gonna die, right? But hopefully it gets to the point, and I wish it were further along, and I can kind of see it coming this way, where the patient will be armed with the information in a cohesive way that doesn't scare them but empowers them.
If I could
just make sure that that happens in the future, I would love that.
I remember the very first day I was in the lab, Steven asked me, he asked me a question of, like, how long do you think until everybody's genetic code is part of their medical record? And I was just never even thought about that question. And my initial answer was like, oh, it's a long time.
Sure.
But then, as you were kind of talking about, seeing all these things like 23andMe and all these different things, it may not be too far off that right as you're born, a little test is done to check all these things. And it scares a lot of people, but it's almost an empowering thing too. Could be,
and that's the fear of a lot of people, right? That you're going to be given this recipe of who you're going to become, and at this level, we're far from it. We can give you a percentage, but that doesn't change the life that you're going to, like, it shouldn't change the life that you're going to lead or the person that you're going to become. But maybe it empowers you to tackle harder problems in your life.
And I mean, these next 10 to 20 years are going to open up a lot of questions of those things, of the ethics behind all these things that we're working on, and how, it's not a matter of like when we're going to be able to do these things, because eventually, sometime we will, but it's just going to be what is the best way to handle it, and it's fascinating.
And hopefully responsibly.
Yeah.
And not too sci-fi, right?
Back into the whenever we heard about CRISPR, they're all about we do everything and just added it all. But I guess just one final question before we kind of get off here, I just want to say thank you for coming out with us today, and thank you for everything. And
you're welcome.
For all the help over the last year and guidance you've given me, and
sorry if I didn't answer all of your questions quite the way you wanted.
And just so everybody knows, before we start recording, Bailey, he's definitely going to come back on once he's once the podcast picks up and he's off doing amazing, incredible things, he's going to be back on to update us on all the awesome research that he's working on. So
yeah, hopefully it's a little less cloudy, and I can give you more precise details as to the problems that I'm hoping to solve.
Well, I guess the last question,
it's
more of a, it's not as much of a question, but it's kind of, what is one piece of advice, or if you, right now we're just speaking to future healthcare professionals, the future researchers in the health field, what is one piece of advice or guidance that you would give them from all that you've been through?
Oh, so many. So many pieces of advice. And I've kind of thought about the saying that I trust people's regrets more than I trust their advice, because there's some type of hindsight to regrets. So maybe that's it.
Nice.
Is trust people's regrets more than their advice, and then making sure that you can learn from other people's examples and mistakes, and try to project yourself in the sense that, I guess, ask tough questions.
Yeah, phenomenal. Well, really, thank you.
Yeah, you're welcome.
Thank you. We got a little shake here at the end. A little shake here at the end. Great.
Well, there you guys go. I hope you enjoyed the episode. As always, if you liked it, give it a 5-star review, subscribe so you don't miss the next episode. And I do want to note that this was the last of the official launch episodes for the Future Healthcare Podcast. Starting next week, we'll be launching an episode every Monday. And next week's Monday launch is actually a special episode, so make sure you guys are around for that. Don't forget, you can always find more information at wearethefuturehealthcare.com. And as always, let's continue these conversations. Let's connect on Facebook. There is the Future Healthcare Facebook page, so hit us up there, or you can connect with me on Twitter or Instagram at Nathan Dollinger on both those platforms, because I love continuing these conversations. You don't even understand how many conversations with the people I've already had since the launch of this podcast, and it's been amazing. Now, with all that said, I just want to say I truly appreciate you guys listening to the podcast every week. Much love. Go and have an incredible day, an amazing weekend, and I will be here next time at the Future of Healthcare Podcast.